Cape York's Noel Pearson has played a key role in charting a way forward in these negotiations. I had the opportunity to sit down with him this morning and he outlined exactly what they hoped to achieve with today's statement. Well, Noel Pearson, today is set to be an historic one, not only for our Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander peoples, but for all Australians.
Yeah, it's an extremely important milestone. I'm just so glad that the Uluru Statement from the Heart has been endorsed by this convention. I think I went into the week really thinking that, you know, goodness knows how this is going to play out. A lot of hard work had been done in the various regions around the country with the dialogues. A lot of very hard work done by Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander representatives at those dialogues. And the challenge for this week was, will we be able to pull the pieces together? It's like 12 pieces of the jigsaw and 13 including the ACT. And the challenge this week was, can we get a synthesis and pull the jigsaw together and come out with a common statement? And we've been able to do that.
It did seem it was going to be an almost impossible task to achieve that in just 3 days. How easy was it with people with so many different ideas and so many different opinions to come together?
Oh, very difficult. But it's like any large political process. I suppose from our point of view, we haven't had many national Indigenous gatherings, you know. For more than a decade, there hasn't been anything like this. And so that was a big factor in the dialogues, but also here this week, I had a lot of people say that, you know, simply we just have not had the opportunity to get together as Indigenous Australians to work in alliance in relation to the issues that are pressing for us. So that was a factor as well, you know, the fact that we have not really convened a national gathering like this for a very long time.
The Uluru Statement that's been endorsed, can you give us the broad brushstrokes of what it contains?
The principal conclusion from the statement is that we need structural reform. You know, there's a confrontation in that document with the fact that we are the most incarcerated peoples per head in the world. And the rates at which our children are alienated from their families, completely unprecedented. And of course, the tragedy of our young people in detention. There's not a society on the face of the earth that has such horrendous rates of distress as marked by prison, child removal and youth detention. And the statement says, well, it can't be because we're particularly criminal. It can't be because we don't love our babies. It can't be because we don't invest hope in our youth for the future. There is a structural dimension to our predicament. You know, our powerlessness is a consequence of our structural condition. And unless we address the structures that disempower us, that mean that our destiny is in the hands of other people and not in our own hands, we're not going to get on top of those problems. Those problems are going to continue to get worse. And so that's the argument of the statement, really, you know, that if you want to turn those, as Australians of goodwill, black and white, if you want to turn around that structural disempowerment, the place we must start is the disempowerment in our constitution. And as long as we have avoided dealing with that disempowerment, our problems have accumulated and we've never been able to turn it around. So, the principal substantial reform that is proposed in the statement is a voice representing the First Nations of Australia. We want that voice entrenched in the Australian Constitution. We want it to be a voice to the Parliament and to the nation and to the executive government of the day. Because if Parliament is going to make laws and policies about our people, we should be able, in all fairness, to scrutinise and to have a say over what is done. And we should be able to advance our right to self-determination through that voice. So this is something, you know, this is something that has a long tradition in our Indigenous political movement. You know, you've got to go, you go back to the early part of the 19th century and find these echoes where our elders and political leaders of the past were advocating for constitutional reform, advocating for a voice to Parliament, a voice in Parliament, and so on. So there's a long pedigree to this proposal, and I believe, and the delegates at this conference believe, that we need a voice that's entrenched in the Constitution. We saw with so many bodies beforehand over the last 50 years, really, you know, ever since the 67 referendum, there'd been, I think, five permutations of different structures, you know, the most substantial of which was ATSIC. And it was just simply, you know, repealed by decision of the government of the day. And so this business of, and yet in North America, you know, and in other jurisdictions, these institutions have lasted over decades and so on. So the constitutional entrenchment is very important. But not just so that it can't be just arbitrarily wiped out. I mean, the institution has got to have a presence. It has got to have a standing. And the Constitution is the most, the highest law in this country, in our Australian democratic system, and it's rightful. It is absolutely rightful that Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander First Nations should be represented in an institution that's recognised by the Australian Constitution.
Noel Pearson, thank you so much for speaking to us on The Point.
Thank you for the opportunity.